So I'm really happy to briefly introduce Mark Ritchie, who I introduced already by email to in-house. So he's joining us virtually from Syracuse. Oops. Oh, shit. Oh, there. Excuse my language. I thought I checked out for a second. sorry. Anyway, Mark is joining us as a virtual sabbatical visitor for the entire year, and hopefully we'll get him in person at least sometime in the fall for, you know, shorter or longer visits. Mark has been involved with SFI for quite a while, in particular through this thing called NETI, the Network for Ecological Theory Integration that a bunch of us are involved with and have met down in Chile and also here and other places in Europe. And Mark has very broad interests and juggles a lot of different kinds of balls. The thing that's most consonant with SFI is his theory work, but he also does really cool field work in the Serengeti, and also has a company of his own that maybe he'll tell us about some other time. But he has many different things he can talk to us about this year, so you'll be hearing from him also today and in the future. And feel free to reach out to him to chat, and he'll probably be reaching out to some of you also. Yep. So Mark, I'll let you take it away.
All right. I'm just going to share my screen. Slideshow. Okay, so I want to start off by at a very sort of high level, in that there's been a lot of work done in both in terms of theoretical physics and its application to various biological and chemical problems about looking at thermodynamics from a fresh perspective, and in particularly as it applies to what we would call far from equilibrium systems. And the sort of lever that I'm talking about today is how all of that might actually apply to biological problems when most biologists don't really follow any of the developments in this field. And so they really have no idea what these kinds of things have to offer and where you can go with it. So what I'm, my basic goal here today is just kind of very briefly go over the high level physics that's I'm pulling into the problem, and then get into the application of it from the point of view of the what I call biological temperature dependence, which is how organisms and biological systems respond to changes in temperature. So first, the high level stuff. So biological systems being far from equilibrium systems that are maintained by a constant influx of energy and materials, they do work. And then they dissipate heat and other materials that are less useful into the environment. So from that perspective, there's been a number of different developments recently using statistical mechanics to look at how fluxes from this large number of simultaneous things, are there constraints on what those fluxes are and what might we expect? So there's several different authors, including Roderick Dewar and Robert Niven, that have derived different, I would say, partial proofs about the idea that a system of fluxes that exist far from equilibrium will tend to exhibit what's called maximum entropy production subject to some sort of constraint. So maximum entropy production has been of interest in lots of different physical and even astrophysical things, such as like what's the entropy production of a black hole. So what I'm going to be doing is trying to show you how you can apply that same kind of concept and solve some problems in biology. So I'm going to introduce you to something. I'm just going to call it the standard model. Obviously, this is not the standard model of physics, but it's the standard model of biological work, if you really want to think about it. So it basically features some sort of reaction site that has usually catalytic enzymes. There are some materials which we'll call a substrate that come in from the external environment These are then undergo some kind of reaction, a molecular collision, and then produce a product. And in some cases, they also produce heat that then has to be dissipated to the environment in order to maintain the ability of the system to stay far from equilibrium and continue to function. And for so far in biology, most of the focus has been on the kinetic energy that's involved in these different processes. So the kinetic energy by which substrate can move to reaction sites or move away from the reaction site, kinetic energy that aids in how molecules react and bump into each other. And then in the essentially lost energy from heat. but the problem with this approach is that it doesn't really allow us to view the system from the perspective of the second law of thermodynamics. And so, and it also sort of assumes there's a proportional influence of kinetic energy, particularly the form of temperature, on the movements of substrates, molecular collision, and movement and heat flux, such that all of this stuff is sort of assumed to go at the same speed through the whole thing. So all that really matters is the sort of efficiency by which this reaction molecular collision process can happen. And in general, the movements of substrates and products is just kind of ignored. I mean, people study these things, but they don't. But the ability of biological systems to do work normally ignores these kinds of movement processes. Okay, so if we look at how the standard model applies to how biochemical reactions respond to temperature, the standard model usually argues that at low temperatures, there's the reaction rate increases at an increasing rate that's basically proportional to the kinetic energy in the system. But typically in data, we find that at some temperature, that rate kind of maxes out and then starts to decline. So the classic argument from most biologists is that the enzymes that are catalyzing this reaction rate basically begin to fall apart, and therefore they're not as efficient or don't have an affinity. and so then the reaction rate goes down after that. but there's kind of a confusion in the literature in that oftentimes what people talk about is that the catalytic enzymes begin to be called deactivate, meaning that they're still sitting there and they haven't really fallen apart, but they're just not actually engaged in combining with the substrate molecules that they're involved with. And so it turns out then that if we actually look at the temperatures at which most biological enzymes fall apart, it actually turns out to be above 50 degrees, but virtually all biological processes seem to max out at temperatures well below that. So the question is if enzymes aren't really falling apart, then what's causing this decline? And if sometimes that involves having the enzyme sitting around, but it's not doing any work, why in the world would that happen? Why keep a super expensive, gigantic molecule sitting in your cell that's not doing anything? So, so there's some discrepancies here that for the most part haven't really been fully explored. There's been some work on trying to better understand what causes this hump in the reaction rate, but by and large, there just haven't been things that seem to answer a lot of the different questions that pop up. So, and this is just kind of a quick review of the literature. If you look at biological temperature optima, mostly they fall below 40 degrees. Sometimes there are lethal temperatures reported at somewhere around 40 degrees. And then, like I said, for a whole host of different enzymes, denaturation doesn't really occur until you get above 50 degrees. And this is just an example of for the enzyme involved in photosynthesis called Rubisco. The rate of electron transport measured as a way of figuring out how much substrate's being processed by Rubisco. You can see there's no fall off in that rate, even though we've well exceeded 40 degrees. But if we look at where photosynthesis begins to go down in performance, then it happens at much cooler temperatures, mostly right around 30. So I had the idea to say, well, what if we apply these concepts from physics about far from equilibrium systems that are operating near steady state? That is, we have a system that persists through time, but is doing work. But then that work is basically converting materials and energy from the external environment into different forms of materials and energy, but in the process, making more of itself and continuing for itself to exist. Then what does that actually look like theoretically? So in here, we have a revised view of things in two important ways. One is that we now explicitly consider the movement of materials in and out of the system. And we consider that perhaps the influence of temperature on those different processes is different. So maybe one of the processes is more sensitive to changes in temperature than the other process. And then we also are going to explicitly consider heat and products, recognizing that that any kind of dissipation of products and heat is increasing the entropy of the surroundings and potentially decreasing or not increasing the entropy of the system itself. So if we think about these from thinking about it rather than from kinetics, we think about changes in entropy. We have the external environment with the substrate as being high quality, meaning that they're able to be used for various work. There's essentially fewer potential microstates, and therefore we can classify that as a lower entropy type system. Then this, as the substrate moves in to the system, then the work that's being done has the potential to produce heat and products, which would decrease entropy inside the system. But if those products and heat can be dissipated back to the environment, then that's increasing the entropy of the surroundings, which then allows the entropy inside the system to stay low. And even though most people look at entropy as this kind of nebulous thing that nobody really knows quite what it is, even though it's usually described as the number of microstates of a system, it actually can be measured and has been measured, you know, thousands of times by biochemists looking at how catalytic enzymes process their substrates. But there's additional things that are contributing to entropy, such as the actual diffusion of transport. And so my thought was, well, what happens if we build essentially an entropy dynamic model for a biological system that becomes sensitive to temperature changes? What does that look like? So the first thing is first a background thing. So biologists don't like curves. So what they normally do is to look at how things respond to temperature is they actually plot some measurement. So here we have the logarithm of the rate versus the inverse of temperature, which if you have some kind of exponentially increasing rate with temperature, when you plot it this way, it is a line. But the weird thing is, because it's the inverse of temperature, hot temperatures are on the left side of the axis and cold temperatures are on the right. So there have been too many studies to count. I reviewed 92 of them that were studying diffusion and transport or product formation. So one is like an actual chemical reaction producing product. The other was measuring the rate at which something was diffusing or being transported. Both in a test tube, which is what we mean by in vitro, or in an actual cell, which we would mean in vivo. So based on this literature review, we can, each one of these studies essentially measured the slope of this line, which is basically showing how the rate of something increased from cold conditions to hot conditions. And the slope of this line is called the activation energy, which is basically how much energy has to be present in the system to get the reaction to go. And the so based on these measurements, we can look to see whether there's a difference in the activation energy between these diffusion transport processes and product formation. So when we look empirically at the data, what we see is pretty striking that the activation energy, or another way of thinking about this is the temperature sensitivity. So if this slope is lower, then the process is less sensitive to temperature than if the slope is steeper. So if you get a lower activation energy, it means this is a lower slope and therefore it's less sensitive. So basically diffusion and transport show much less sensitivity to temperature increases than does product formation. And this is true whether we look at it in a test tube or whether we look at it in actual cells. So this then brings up the point I made earlier that there's a sort of disproportionate influence of temperature on the different processes that are contributing to this far from equilibrium near steady state system. So we can explore what the implications of those are. So I'm gonna try to do this. I swore I wasn't gonna use a bunch of equations because it didn't really feel like that was super necessary. So I'm gonna try to use these kind of schematics and walk you through this so you can try to understand how this works, at least in terms of the modeling. So if we start with a cool situation and some amount of substrate in the outside environment, then some of that has to move into some reaction site. So we can track how much of that substrate is inside the system. And then there's some, this is, gets converted to some product, which is the red box, at some rate represented by the thickness of this arrow. And most people may remember if they had various from chemistry, however long that ago that was, that all reactions basically proceed both forward and backward. But we always think of it as a reaction as having a net forward reaction because the formation of product far outstrips the conversion of the product back into the substrate. But it's important to remember that all these reactions have both a forward and a backward step that can be influenced by how much product is sitting around inside the system. So then that product then gets moved out of the system along with heat, but then the system is also receiving heat from outside the system. So under cool conditions, the rate of product formation is sufficiently low and the system is limited by kinetics, meaning that the problem is getting molecules to bump into each other. And so we can classify that as having sort of low entropy production. And so there's no problem at all with being able to dissipate the heat and products because they're just not being generated very quickly. Under warmer conditions, then essentially these same processes are happening, except that they're going at somewhat faster rate. So product is formed at a faster rate, but in this case, the ability to dissipate that product and move it out of the system goes fast enough that it can kind of keep up with the rate at which it gets formed. And because there's more product being delivered, then there's more heat being dissipated. But then the environment itself is warmer, so there's essentially more radiation influencing the system. So this is the system at which we're essentially getting maximum entropy production. And in the modeling, we show that essentially diffusion and transport and kinetics are sort of in balance as to what's limiting the reactions. Kind of think of it as a co-limitation. So it depends on both molecules bumping into each other as well as molecules moving out of the system. Now, if we make it a little bit warmer and we assume there's really no change in the catalytic enzymes involved, then what happens is that the rate at which you can form products gets so fast that the ability to move product out of the system goes down. And in addition, any heat that's generated, it's harder for it to show a net dissipation because the system is warmer and it's receiving more heat from the external environment. So the inability of the movement of molecules to keep up with the rate at which the products are being formed, plus the more difficulty in dissipating heat because the environment is warmer, causes entropy production to go back down again. And the main thing is that with these products building up because they can't move out, then the reaction rate, the reverse reaction rate now picks up. So the total net reaction now goes down, even though the rate of initial product formation is very high. A lot of those products are being reversed or converted back into substrate. So this is essentially the process by which, as you crank up the temperature, you start to impose different limiting factors on the way a reaction works. So we can see this graphically if we show the reaction rate here on the y-axis as a function of temperature. At low temperature, the system is limited by the enzyme catalysis or kinetics. Then at some temperature, the lack of sensitivity of diffusion or transport kicks in and may limit the reaction rate. But at some temperature, the system gets to the point where the ability to produce entropy in the surroundings becomes limiting to the reaction. And essentially the reaction then starts, the reverse reaction starts to become so large that the net reaction then starts to go down. And so these curves are actually mathematically what's predicted to happen. If you're thinking, well, that doesn't really look like a lot of the data that I've seen, it's simply because if you have almost any kind of noise in this, it'll be very difficult to distinguish this from some sort of more normal looking curve. So nobody really knows whether these transitions happen or not. These are just theoretical model predictions at this point. And the graph on the left is taking this exact same graph, but just re-expressing it as what's called this Arrhenius function that I talked about earlier. We have the log of the rate on the y-axis plotted versus the inverse of temperature. So we have cold on the right, hot on the left. So we can see that during enzyme catalysis, we have this steeper slope corresponding to the higher activation energy. Then when diffusion or transport limitation starts to kick in, then it's lower sensitivity causes this line to sort of have a lower slope or sort of flattens the curve. And then at the hottest temperatures, we see a decline as the system becomes now limited by its ability to produce entropy in the surroundings. So one of the really cool things that comes out of the modeling is that it predicts all of these things that the optimal temperature of any kind of process will depend on a lot of different reaction characteristics or even conditions in the environment. So for example, we can say under what conditions would cause this optimal temperature where the reaction rate maxes out to become cooler or shift, have this curve shift to the left. Well, it turns out that that's higher in, I'm not gonna go through this detail, but basically anything that makes the formation of product faster will cause this temperature optimum to shift to the left or to cooler temperatures. So increasing enzyme concentration, increasing the catalytic capacity of the enzyme or the efficiency of the enzyme will tend to cause this this optimal temperature to shift in the direction of a cooler temperature. In contrast, if we have higher equilibrium constant, which basically is an index kind of how favorable the reaction is. In other words, how easy is it for the reaction to go, and will the reaction still go even if there's far more product than substrate? And as we'll talk about in a little bit, an example of a more favorable reaction would be like metabolism of sugars, whereas reactions that have a lower KQ would be things like synthesis reactions that often even have to have extra energy added to them to get them to go. So anything that makes reaction more favorable tends to push the temperature optimum to cause it to increase. And so you can express these again in this Arrhenius function type space where we have a log of some sort of characteristic of the reaction as a function of temperature. And so some things will show a negative slope, which is what happens if you're saying that the characteristic will increase as temperatures become hotter, or they'll show a positive slope if the characteristic will tend to decrease as things become hotter. Now, it's really important to notice that the standard model for biological temperature dependence does not predict any of these relationships. It basically assumes that none of these things are important in whether or not. It's just all about the enzyme. And so, so I just want to stress that all of these predictions are things that say, it makes it very easy to go out and say, well, what do the data show? What is there anything in the real world that really supports this little sort of hypothetical differential equation model that in which we can find an optimal temperature? So what I'm gonna be basically talking about in the rest of the talk is showing you some examples of the predictions and some of the data that kind of would suggest that perhaps we really do need to rethink what we know about biological temperature dependence. So let's talk about reaction favorability. So an easy way to think about this is that we can plot the KEQ or the log of KEQ as a function of the inverse of temperature. So we're in this Arrhenius function space. So as examples of favorable reactions would be the hydrolysis of sugars, like you do when you're using your muscles. And then there's protein synthesis, which is what you're doing when you're making more copies of a cell or making antibodies if you are sick, those kinds of things. So I reviewed 128 enzyme studies. Most of the enzymes are from bacteria, but some of them are from eukaryotic organisms. And what we found in the review is pretty strong support for the idea that, of the prediction that as you go from cold to hot, that the optimal temperature should increase for more favorable reactions. So this is, you know, a review of tons of studies that have really nothing to do with each other. It's just different things evaluating one enzyme or another from a different organism. Some of the enzymes are the same. In other words, different dots represent the same enzyme, some not. Some of these are from bacteria that are considered thermophiles, meaning they're adapted to function at high temperatures. And you can see that, interestingly, most of those enzymes are only engaged in very favorable reactions. But interestingly, they sit essentially on the same curve. So one of the cool things that's predicted by this is it basically says that different biological systems that are engaged in different kinds of reactions should operate at different temperatures. Because if you're a system that is in the business of processing sugar in metabolism, then you probably want to operate at a higher temperature than something that was engaged in synthesizing proteins. So some very recent studies using temperature sensitive dyes have shown that, for example, mitochondria, which are mainly engaged in energy generating reactions, according to the calibration of the fluorescence of the dye, are calculated to be at 52 degrees centigrade, whereas ribosomes within the cell, which are engaged in protein synthesis, are at around 35 degrees centigrade. So the whole idea that within a single cell, we have organelles that are this vastly different in temperature was sort of new, and lots of questions about the methods and sort of thing. The interesting thing is that in this literature review, if I take all of the synthesis reactions, and I measure the optimal temperatures that were measured for those reactions, they all average at around 35 degrees C. And if I take all of the hydrolysis reactions, which are much more favorable, and I measure the optimal temperature, or I look at the mean optimal temperature that was measured for those enzymes, they average out to around 52 degrees centigrade. So these numbers may not be very accidental. They may reflect the fact that mitochondria are engaged in much more favorable reactions, and therefore being at a hotter temperature is actually what's helping the mitochondrion performance function. So another prediction is that the optimal temperature should go down with increasing enzyme concentration. So again, in our Arrhenius space, this means that at cold temperatures, we should expect colder optimal temperatures at higher enzyme concentrations and hotter optimal temperatures at lower enzyme concentrations. So the data set here is looking at four different types of enzymes. This is all measured in test tubes. And so each one of the, this is multiple experiments with these same enzymes just done at different concentrations, usually by completely different authors. So what's actually kind of amazing about these data is that for these four different enzymes, they all kind of fit on the same curve, or at least it's pretty clustered. And statistically, you can't tell the difference between any of these lines, and that they all show this roughly the same slope, and that and all the slope is in the direction predicted by this reaction displacement model under maximum entropy production. So this is kind of pretty amazing support for the idea that if you have lower enzyme concentration, you're going to probably exhibit your maximum reaction rate at a hotter temperature than if you have a higher enzyme concentration. We can actually see this translated into the elements that are usually limiting in the production of enzymes. So one of those is nitrogen. So that nitrogen is often limiting in ecological systems. And so the model would predict that if we have low availability of nitrogen, so that makes it more difficult for an organism to have high concentration of enzymes if they have low access to nitrogen. So we'd predict them to show their maximum rate at a higher temperature if they have less access to nitrogen and less nitrogen concentration in their. So in this case, we're going to be looking at plants. So if we have a lower nitrogen concentration in the leaves, then we expect that temperature optimum to be higher. Whereas if we have a higher nitrogen concentration leads, we expect that temperature optimum to be lower. So this is a data set from an experiment by a student of Fakhri Bazaz back in 2004, where they measured photosynthesis rate of bean plants grown at different temperatures and under three different nitrogen addition rates. And these are all accompanied having different higher nitrogen in the leaf tissue corresponded to having extra nitrogen added to their environment. So what's cool is that we can see as we go from the control, and as we add more nitrogen, we shift the optimal temperature for photosynthesis in a decreasing direction. So just changing the amount of nitrogen in the system can shift that optimum from about 37 all the way down to about 32. And 5 degrees centigrade may not seem like a whole lot, but as we know from all the news we hear about global warming, that even on average temperatures decline by 1 or 2 degrees centigrade, we see relatively massive changes in the way systems function. And so this may be one of the reasons for that. And so we can also see similar kinds of patterns for different plant species, for yeast, for phytoplankton, and then for bacteria, that they all show this negative relationship between element concentration and temperature. So if we go from cool temperatures to hot temperatures, we see a decline and a corresponding decline in element concentration. So I just want to, the last sort of example I'm going to explore is something that might be a little dear to work that Jen's done over her career. And so that's, we can actually make predictions if these element concentrations are sensitive to temperature. Then this suggests that the basic functioning of ecosystems in terms of trophic interactions is likely to be highly affected. So the basic prediction is that the N or P, this could be nitrogen, phosphorus, but could be other things, sodium, other kinds of things that might be limiting to consumers. But we would see that as we go from cold, so now we're not in Arrhenius space anymore. We're going from cold on the left to hot on the right. As we increase temperature, we should see those element concentrations decline in some sort of nonlinear fashion like this. And so we might imagine that at under colder temperatures, because the primary producers are much higher in element concentration, then they can support more trophic levels and potentially more species under those conditions than under hotter conditions, where if potentially fewer species and trophic levels because of the overall lower element concentration of those systems. So the data I'm going to show right now is just one particular study. I think there's like a whole huge data mining study that could be done to look at this and try to factor out some of the other factors that tend to co-vary with environmental temperature. But this is just a study from macroinvertebrates in freshwater springs that shows you increased temperature. And they were comparing like thermal springs with non-thermal springs. And so I put a box around the data that cover the temperature range over which we would expect ecosystems to be normally functioning. Like you're not really dealing with organisms that can't tolerate the temperature or should be able to tolerate the temperature. So if the temperature is having some effect, it's got to be through something else besides the fact that there's just fewer organisms that can tolerate the extreme temperatures. And so while it's not an overwhelming support, it certainly is in line with the idea that you might see fewer species and or trophic levels in systems as you increase temperature. They didn't really measure the element concentration of their primary producers in the study, so it's hard to know whether that corroborating piece of evidence is true. But my point is that if we really start thinking about what's driving biological response to temperature, then we start to make predictions like this. And so it might spur people to really start studying it in a more rigorous way.
Hey Mark, I have a question.
Yep.
Jen here. So, you know, it's a little bit of a counterintuitive, you know, hypothesis. At what scales do you think that this relationship might hold? I mean, you're showing this at a kind of small scale. Of course, we intuitively think of something different happening at very large latitudinal scales.
Yeah. So the point is that, like, if you look at latitude, then you've got other things varying with latitude, such as precipitation. So there's some interface between, if you're thinking terrestrial, there's precipitation and temperature that kind of works together. You also have like different numbers of periods in which we have species that are able to co-evolve under particular environmental conditions. So because you're invoking different factors and different processes, that I agree that there may be things that sort of totally cross this up. And so I wouldn't at this point just make some sort of blanket statement that anytime you decrease temperature or increase temperature, you're going to lose species. But perhaps what these freshwater spring data suggest is that if we look at systems like an aquatic system that are somewhat buffered against a lot of their factors, although there may be some, you know, like geomorphological contributions to this that aren't being considered, like you have substrate that has more mineral nutrients in it to begin with, And so regardless of temperature, that influences things.
Okay.
So I think that, again, it might be something that you see on a small scale because you've been able to control for a lot more confounding factors. And so that's why I'm saying that if you really want to look at this on a scale that's kind of meaningful for global change, then you would definitely need to find ways of factoring out the other sort of known influences and see if you see the signal, if you will, of temperature in this way. Okay, so just to kind of sum up what I've done, the motivation for this work was to sort of say, well, we've got all these really cool developments and understanding how far from equilibrium systems are functioning. But what happens if we actually apply that to real world problems? And so if we take a broader view of the way that biological systems function, to think of them as reaction displacement, meaning diffusion or transport systems, and we look at them from the perspective of tracking entropy that might be subject to different constraints, then are we able to predict something about real biology that we can then pose predictions and test? And so it turns out that applying this to the temperature sensitivity of biological systems gives us a pretty prediction-rich theory that says that the way organisms respond to temperature may depend on a lot of different factors and not just on being able to evolve or produce enzymes that can hold together at higher temperatures. It's not to say that that kind of process is not important. It just means that there are a lot of other things. And as you've seen through the examples, there's potentially lots of implications about as we get a warmer world, particularly in places that are already warm, if they continue to increase in temperature, we may see some surprising responses to that. Anyway, that's all I've got for today. Thanks for listening and happy to entertain any questions.
Great. Thank you, Mark. If anybody has questions for Mark, just unmute and go for it. And Mark, if you want to pull your slides down.
Yeah, I'll just stop my share.
Yes, I have one comment building on what Jen said. Thanks Mark, for a great talk, by the way, Mark. I think disentangling the differences between the temperature response that you showed in terms of number of species at the end and what's happening with latitude might be interesting, because there could be a difference between what happens in a single environment as temperature changes for that single environment to the species, yeah, and what happens across environments where temperature is varying but has been maintained at a constant value for a long period of time, right? And maybe that would be one way to untangle sort of that apparent conflict where with latitude, even if you hold like biomass or NPP constant, you still mm-hmm. see diversity changes with temperature, yeah, but those presumably are all in steady state, and that's different than changing temperature in a single environment. So that, I think there's a lot of rich stuff to think about there.
Yeah, and I think the terrestrial environments are going to be the most difficult ones to deal with for a couple of reasons. One is that you have these extra factors like precipitation that varies, and temperature precipitation has its own sort of physics that goes along with things. Plus, a lot of organisms can do all kinds of adaptive temperature management or thermoregulation by picking little microhabitats. So we saw that in an experiment I did once with grasshoppers, where if they were subject to predation risk, they picked, they no longer used the warmer habitats because they were safer. But so that would then have implications for their ability to produce eggs and so on and so forth. And so one could argue there's the temperature of the environment and then there's the temperature of the organism. And in terrestrial environments, those are often very different. And so it's really tough. So I think simple aquatic systems like those springs that I was looking at would be more amenable to that. But I agree that the time that organisms have had to deal with a particular environment, and that kind of sort of co-evolutionary potential, if you will, probably has a big influence on things. So if we're thinking about like global warming, we're thinking about, okay, here I have a set of organisms, and they're going to be subjected to relatively rapid environmental change. So how are they going to respond? But you see little signs of it. For example, people have started noticing that as things have gotten warmer, a lot of crop, the nutrition of crops has actually declined. And when everything else is basically the same, they're irrigated, they've pumped full of fertilizer, so they've kind of controlled for a lot of those variables in the field. And so, ecologists have this tendency to just take a factor and go look and see if it things, and without controlling for all the other things. But I think it just to really see if it's something that's gonna that deserves a lot of attention, need to do a more rigorous analysis than what I did. I'm just kind of putting out the idea that, you know, I always call it a smell test. If it passes the smell test for just, you know, a quick kind of look at things where it ought to be working, then maybe it's worthy of further study.
Yeah, thanks.
Yep.
I had a quick question.
Yep.
Thank you for a great talk. I kind of had a question just about the basic mechanism or formulation of the model. So should we think of it like a Michaelis-Menten type enzyme reaction? And then the idea is that when you can't diffuse the heat or the product for the very last reaction, it builds up.
Yep.
And the last reaction starts to go backwards. Is that?
Yes. Yeah. So the idea is that if you get too warm, then the diffusion and transport doesn't increase fast enough to keep up with the rate at which products are formed. So mm-hmm. cause a buildup in the concentration of the product, which then increases the reverse reaction rate. So the net reaction then goes down. And then also the issue of dissipating heat. So it's kind of like, if we're exercising in a hot environment, we have a really hard time dissipating enough heat. And so we can get physiological breakdown as a consequence of that. So it's the same kind of problem in that heat dissipation is more difficult, and then you have the reverse reaction. So both of those processes are important. And by tracking entropy, you kind of keep track of both of those things.
So I have a question, which is, it seems like a very direct test of this theory is, you know, presumably people have been studying these reactions in vitro for mm-hmm. decades. So have people actually observed that the product concentration goes up enough in these in vitro experiments to drive? Because I mean, that to me is the kind of, I don't know the numbers involved, but often, I think the second step is favored by like orders and orders and orders of magnitude forward.
Yeah.
And intuitively, I would think, wow, to start to go backwards sufficiently, you'd have to raise the product concentration by like 20 orders of magnitude or something. That may be completely wrong, but sort of.
Well, it's really interesting because so the phenomenon in biochemical studies is called product inhibition. And so most people, when they set up the experiment, they're not really worried about whether or not the reaction can continue at steady state. What they're trying to do is try to characterize the enzyme. So what they usually do is they actually run the reaction for incredibly short periods of time, specifically to avoid product inhibition.
And so
what it suggests is that even in water solution, the issue of diffusing through water, which should be much easier than diffusing through a very spatially complex cell, you still see signs that there's some kind of a product inhibition. And so biochemists have experienced this for so long, they now have protocols that are like, well, you can only run a reaction for X number of seconds, and that's the only time period that we care about, because it's the time that the reaction is sort of running forward without product inhibition. So the idea—
But you're saying that the inverted U-shaped curve that's seen in vitro is still due to product inhibition.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at, if you look over time at the amount of product formation. It starts out high and then it just goes down over time. And highly favorable reactions. And that's with enzymes that are essentially in solution at random positions within the test tube. So it's really hard to go into a field and say to these guys that, yeah, your product inhibition is actually telling you something and you've just kind of not paid attention to it. And I think that part of that is because they're not trying to run the reactions at steady state. And people have suggested to me I should go to chemical engineers who are busy trying to produce massive amounts of product over long periods of time and figure out what they've had to do to deal with it. But I just never ever had time to sort of really dig into that literature. But it's possible that if you looked at these reactions in different contexts, where you're looking at trying to look at how they're maintained at steady state over long time periods, that you'd see these kind of trade-offs come into play.
Thank you.
Yep.
I had a similar question. So, right, the explanation that you gave doesn't depend on dealing with enzymes, right? In theory, it should also hold for simpler reactions.
Mm-hmm.
So is there some very simple reactions in which you could show the same type of curve?
That's totally possible. I didn't really look at those, but looking at like just regular inorganic chemistry or electrochemical interactions, stuff that don't involve catalysts. It's basically a conversion of substrate to product, and whether there's an enzyme catalyzing or not really doesn't matter. For sure, that if you looked at a subset of those, you should probably see the same thing, and you would predict essentially the same results, like for particularly as far as like reaction favorability.